And that's the world. And like, that's the world we're in. So what's being reported? What knowledge and whose truth? And like, we can all go back like to the DDT stories, those of you that have the, know about the DDT, like from the 40s, 50s, the big salvation of our planet Earth, stopping the insects, but then it was a big chemical for our health. And nicotine, like nicotine, how long were there scientists saying nicotine has nothing to do with lung cancer, and nicotine is not the danger and all that stuff? Science can talk whatever they want, depending on the funder. So who profits? And we create a dependence of the seed, chemicals, fertilizers. So the continued poor outcomes of modern foods, like our current foods, our current environment, living environment, we get the cancers, heart disease, dental health, obesity, anorexia, bulimia, allergies, diabetes, behavior, manic depression issues, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, all these issues, we get more and more diseases and we go to the hospital. We have to do prevention. And prevention is here the good food and the good body care products to stop the chemicals going into our body. So we don't need a hospital. And like from the science, like the independent science, they say that only 5% of all those diseases is truly genetically based. But like now, if one in three people get cancer, it's with the epigenetics, those genes have become exposed and become active. They were sleeping with our parents, but through our food they awaken and they cause them the cancer. So we have to rebuild our immune system to stop those genes expressing themselves again. So we are into the system of curing diseases. And like the CSIRO flagship of preventive health is on that track. That they try to find, and I question that all the time, and I then finally got the answer. Because they try to prevent a disease from becoming more deadly. They wait for a disease to pop up and then develop a drug to stop it getting worse. Because there's no money in prevention. Like if science does prevention, there's no product to sell, so nobody pays for you. But we pay tax to our CSIRO. So the CSIRO should be preventive health, the true prevention. Coming up with the things I talk about, prevention of good food, no chemicals, eating brown bread instead of white bread, all those things. But CSIRO hasn't done that. They are obliged to the powers of our society. So we have to go to the true prevention. So do we need GM? And then there was a big international assessment about the future of agriculture by the United Nations agencies, and the World Bank was involved. Like in 2006 and 2007, they had this big study with 400 scientists around the world studying the impact of how can planet Earth survive with 9 billion people and how can we prevent poverty and disease and all those issues. And they came up with a report. And in that report, they say GM crops will not play a substantial role in addressing the key problems of climate change, biodiversity loss, hunger and poverty. All countries in the world signed that document except United States, Canada and Australia. Did the politicians ask you whether we want to sign it, yes or no? So we are on the wrong track. How can we get out of it? How can we obtain better solutions without GM? And then I go to the great Albert Einstein, because Albert said, no problem will be solved with the same level of thinking that created it in the first place. So you have to step out of our square and look at that from a different angle and ask why, why? Like, and all the people here in the expo have asked that question, why? And they changed their tech. But like, we here and maybe all the visitors, most of the visitors are then called alternative. Alternatives, greenies, alternatives. But we are to the true health of our society. So that step to the real world is still to be made. But of course, as the expo becomes bigger and we get more distribution of the information, we can make the change. So we need new thinking, that our thinking has to change on how to live and how to care for ourselves. And we need new systems, and that's like agriculture of biological food production, that we go into the food. And that's the pyramid of life on planet Earth. You see at the bottom, soil. Soil is the foundation of life on Earth, because it has to grow the food that we eat. Without food, we die. So soil is the foundation of planet Earth, but we have degraded the soils. We have killed the organisms in the soils with our fertilizers and chemicals. And the wind blows the soil away, the water washes the soil away, and the microbes in the soil are the first living organisms in the soil that make the soil healthy. And we have killed those microbes with our chemicals and fertilizers. In organic produce, the microbes are activated again. So, and the same in our body. Like microbes in our body, in our gut, are of prime importance for our health. And like the science world now says that our immune system is for 60-70% governed by the gut, in our, the bacteria in our gut. So if we have a decimated life of, in our gut, then our immune system is low, we get all the diseases. So we have to build up our internal system. The same as the soil. And I'll show you now some pictures of the soil. Like on the left-hand side is a healthy soil with all the bacteria active. On the right-hand side is a not healthy soil. You pull the plant out and you shake the healthy soil, the soil is glued to the roots. The right-hand side, the soil falls off. You can do that example in your own garden. Here's an example like the good farming, common size on the left, where the roots go like 60 centimeters deep, black soil, all carbon in the soil. Because Colin has pumped 300 tons carbon in the soil. Absolutely amazing how much carbon you can pump in the soil. And it goes deep, see the black color. This is the neighbor. And the neighbor is his brother, is best practice farming. The roots go till here, not there. So this is the healthy soil and all activating the soil biology. And we get the deep. That's why we don't need GM. Because a GM plant on the right can make roots only like 10 centimeters deep and will die easily and low yields. So here we have, like on the left, a wheat plant sown at the same day in the same paddock. The left-hand side was treated biological, the right-hand side conventional. The same, so it's sown at the same date. On the left-hand side, you see this massive root system. On the right-hand side, the roots try to get through the hard soil. This is in Gippsland. A conventional dairy farmer with the roots only like 1.5 inch deep on the grey clay. This is the farm next door of Ron and Beth, with the roots again going like 50 centimeters deep and this 30 centimeter thick black layer, all carbon pumped in the soil. Soil fertility. Don't need GM. This is the soil food web. Like we go from the left, from the green plants growing in the soil with the organic matter, the carbon formation in the soil. And each level of organisms eats the previous level. And of course, on the right-hand side, we have the bird eating the beetle, eating the mite, eating... And of course, with our chemical farming, the birds have disappeared. Because the beetle didn't survive, because the beetle didn't have the bugs to eat, and the bugs didn't have the fungi to eat. So if we disturb the food web, we kill life on planet Earth. So we have to restore that whole food web in our paddocks, in our home gardens. And that's what the organic farming is doing. And then we get the good produce coming out. And then we get contented animals. Animals that are calm. Because there's direct implication of the minerals you eat and your brain activity. If you don't have enough minerals, like magnesium, then the brain goes flighty. And you become hyperactive and things like that. So animals on a healthy soil, they graze grass with all the minerals. And they are calm and they walk and they lay down. And they have less time for grazing. Improve fertility, like very quick fertility. And like one story, when I was on Ron and Beth's farm, absolutely amazing, that nature starts to work again. Like the cows, when the cows are calving, then, and a front comes from the Southern Ocean in Gippsland, very cold, then calves are dying in the field. So the neighbors ring up, Ron, do you have a calf for me? Because Ron's calves all survive. Why? The cow holds the calf inside, the front goes through, and the calf is dropped the next day. That's biology, that's nature. So we get our natural systems back in place with our biological farming. And how good is that? So we get high quality produce, productive, all the minerals. And because all the animals that graze on that healthy grass have all the minerals, because the bugs in the soil, they make minerals in the soil soluble. And those soluble minerals are then fed to the plant. So you don't need fertilizer. Because fertilizer, what we can buy for our home gardens as well, is water-soluble nitrogen, etc. Which is water-soluble, the plant can suck it up. We don't need biology for the fertilizers. But for the biological fertilizer, we need the bugs in the soil to make them soluble, that the plant can take them up. And then the plant takes them up in balance, and all the minerals are in there that necessary for our body to be healthy. And because they're healthy cells in the bodies, those animals don't have food throat, mastitis, blood, pink eye, jonies, ticks, worms, they all are healthy. Because all those one statement about the bugs again. Because we always heard about germs, and then you use that liquid soap in your house that kills 99% of the bacteria. Throw that stuff out of the window, because it's bad. Like, in our world, 90% of the germs are beneficial. 90% of the bacteria are beneficial. It's only 10% that are negative. But the 90% beneficials protect our body, protect the plants, protect living organisms from the bad ones. So if we kill the bad ones, if we kill the good ones, then the bad ones have more entry. And of course, then you say, well, if we kill the good ones, the bad ones will be killed as well. Now, the bad ones are always stronger. They survive better. So the summary, GM is not the solution. Engineering is not precise. It's not engineering. It's a shotgun approach. Single genes in a complex system can't solve the problem. Genes are switching on and off, depending on the conditions around the gene. And we are at the cutting edge of knowledge. And at that cutting edge of knowledge, that the geneticists start to measure things, the gene activities, etc. And at that cutting edge of knowledge, they create that GM technology. But we don't know what is beyond that cutting edge. That's why we have to be precautionary and not dive into that world too quickly. And we don't know what we don't know. And we never know what we don't know because we don't know what we don't know. But then we have to use our imagination, our intuition, our feelings. And who of you has a green thumb? Yeah, good. Because a green thumb is that feeling, that intuition. And like with that, you don't need a recipe because you feel, you sense, you communicate with your plants and animals. And then the positive elements overwhelm all the negatives. And the science world can't quantify that green thumb because the green thumb are energies that come out of the... Because all the plants have energies, they radiate energies, living plants and human bodies. And with a green thumb, you can sense those energies and you know what's good and what's bad. So what our generation, our next generations, our kids now have to learn again, all the little ones that now play with the animals and the plants in the play yard, they have to become biosensitive again.